latest TV entertainment news with me, Andrew Kay. I am particularly keen to catch Home, I'm Darling, having missed it in the West End. Now on tour and starring BAFTA winner Jessica Ransom, whose TV career has seen her in Doc Martin, Armstrong and Miller and Horrible Histories, Diane Keen, who appeared in Doctors, Rings on Their Fingers and my favourite, the Cuckoo Waltz, and Neil McDermott from both EastEnders and The Royal. And this is a thought-provoking new comedy by Laura Wade, who penned both Posh and The Riot Club. Home, Home, Darling is about one woman's quest to be the perfect 1950s housewife. Let's hear what audiences have to say about the production.
What I loved about the show was it really drew me into the 50s. You know, I really felt like we were there. The set, the casting, the way they spoke even was great and really, you know, brought you to what it must have felt like to be in the 50s.
Yeah, the set was lovely. Reminded me of growing up. A bit nostalgic.
Thoroughly enjoyed it, and a nice little twist the way it changed the whole mood.
It was sort of quite mind-boggling and really sort of brought to life today and what it was like in the 50s.
I thought the show was amazing. I think it's a lovely love story, and that in the face of like the adversities that people have.
The mother's monologue was really thought-provoking because, you know, we grew up in the 50s, just struck home, and it was like the dark to the light.
Oh, I loved it, especially the dancing between every scene, and the music was great. It was really good. It really put you in a good mood.
I would love to be able to dance like they do.
Nobody needed a gym back in those days.
No, you didn't. Just went dancing. Everyone could jive. That was normal.
Well, if like me, you are a child of the 50s, I know, I don't look it. This show promises to be a nostalgic joy, and yes, Jessica Ransom does appear to be wearing costumes culled from my mum's wardrobe. Home, I'm Darling is at the Devonshire Park Theatre in Eastbourne from the 7th of March, with a second chance to catch it at Theatre Royal Brighton from the 11th of April. Looking way into the future now, but with two shows that will surely be sellouts. First, the music of Zimmer versus Williams, the two greats of film music, and a list of films that includes Gladiator, Superman, Harry Potter, Inception, Jurassic Park, The Dark Knight Rises, Pirates of the Caribbean, Star Wars, The Da Vinci Code, Indiana Jones, E.T., and many more. The London Concert Orchestra will perform epic scores celebrating two of the greatest film music composers of all time. Let's get a taste of that genius.
The general became a slave. Slave who became a gladiator. The gladiator defied an emperor. Only a famous death will do.
The frost. Sometimes it makes the blade stick.
You find yourself alone, riding in green fields with the sun on your face. Do not be troubled. Well, you are in Elysium, and you're already dead! Others, what we do in life echoes in eternity.
I like Hispania. I shall cheer for you.
My name is Maximus Decimus Meridius, loyal servant to the true Emperor Marcus Aurelius. Father to a murdered son, husband to a murdered wife, and I will have my vengeance in this life or the next.
Today I saw a slave become more powerful than the Emperor of Rome.
Strength and honor, strength and honor.
Are you a man who once said death smiles at us all? All a man can do is smile back.
Smile for me now.
Am I not? keeping him. You can't tell. Not even Mom. What's happening? I don't know. Something scary.
You look great!
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
E.T. phone home. It's too bumpy. We'll have to walk from here. You gotta find it. E.T., stay with me. I love you.
Where are we going?
Follow me!
I'll be right here.
Zimmer followed by Williams, and you can hear this immense catalogue of cinematic genius at the Brighton Centre on the 11th of November, and tickets have just gone on sale, so get in there fast. Next, a surefire sellout, as fans of a certain age will be reigniting their puppy love and heading out to see perhaps the biggest boy star of all time, Donny Osmond. Donny was by far the best known of the Utah clan's child star phenomenons who rose to fame on the Andy Williams TV shows. And the 65-year-old is still looking and sounding great. Here he is in Las Vegas earlier this year with that huge hit.
Someone help me. Help me. This is not a puppy love.
I wish I had that much energy, let alone looking and sounding that good still. Donny is at the Brighton Centre on the 12th of December, and it will sell out for sure. Join me after the break. Hello and welcome back to Latest TV News with me, Andrew Kay. I'm moving away from entertainment in the second half today and talking about education and inequality. And I'm joined in the studio by Curtis James. Hello, Curtis. Thanks for coming in. You're making a podcast about inequality, specifically in Brighton and Hove. Tell me a little bit about that.
Yeah, so the podcast is called Class Divide. It's come out of
a campaign group that's been running for the last couple of years in East Brighton called Class Divide. Our aim as a campaign is to fix education inequality in Brighton and Hove, of which there's a lot of it. And the podcast really is to tell the story of what that impact is around education, some of the history and where it comes from, and to try and get people in the city to sort of be aware of it and to start taking action to fix it.
Well, I don't think we are aware of it. What sort of statistics are we looking at?
So in 2019, the sort of data from government and from the local authority showed that only 37% of children from East Brighton attained basic GCSE grades, compared to 69% of children across the rest of the city. So you can already see that's a big attainment gap there.
That's a very, very difficult statistic to absorb. I mean, 37? It's horrifying in a sense to think that in a city that prides itself on being, you know, champions of equality and being a great place to live, that can be so radical. How does it compare to the rest of the country?
Well, the national average is around 50%. So already, you know, we're way below the national average. Obviously, citywide, we're above. That data is from 2019. But the thing is, if you look back at the historical data, it's bad for a long, long time. And there have been multiple attempts and strategies and frameworks locally to try and close that gap.
So why have they failed?
Well, we're unsure. We're unsure about why they failed. We have asked questions of the local authority about what they've learned from those past strategies, and we await their answers. There are two new strategies in place that are attempting to fix these attainment gaps, and it's early days for those. They've only been going for the last 12 months, so we'll be interested to see if they actually make a difference. I mean, you know, I don't want to beat up on the local authority. They've got a lot of challenges, but it does feel as if they are often very good at coming up with strategies, but when it comes to actually taking action, it's rather lacking.
It strikes me that is the major problem, but what actually creates this inequality? There must be one factor which is really impacting. What is that?
There isn't just one, but I could tell you about some of the headline ones. You know, we've got increasing numbers of poverty in our country, and that has a massive impact on families and the children's ability to learn, for those families to support their children with learning. That then ends up at the school gate and in the school classrooms with teachers, not just having to teach, but support all kinds of social issues and give that kind of support to those kids. So that's one thing. There's another thing that goes way back to, and I don't want to bore you with government stuff and policy stuff, but there were big changes in the late 80s around how schools operated. And what that brought in was choice and parents being able to choose the school their children went to. Now, that choice is a great thing. You would think it could be a great thing, but that choice isn't available to everyone in the city. You have to sort of spend maybe 20% more on your house to actually access that kind of choice and live in the city centre to access some of those schools. Whereas if you're living on the outskirts in East Brighton, you don't really get a choice. You go to your local school. So, you know, it's another thing, this idea that we have a school system and parents can go school shopping.
This is the whole thing about catchment areas and actually just having to go where you're told.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's the local authority don't have many levers they can pull to change this stuff. You know, the government have stripped a lot of the decision-making process from local authority. But one of the things they can change is catchment areas. And as a campaign, it's one of the things we would really like to see changed in this city. And we understand over the years it's been a very tricky political issue. I've heard rumours that politicians have said, I don't even want that coming up on the doorstep near election time because it's so tricky and so negative. But I think it's something we need to have a proper discussion around in the city. And for it to go way beyond parents, because kids being educated properly doesn't just impact parents in the city, it impacts all of us.
It impacts all our futures, because in fact youth of today are our supporters as we grow older. I'm fascinated by what you were saying about teachers and their responsibilities, because primarily their job is to educate, but surely they're becoming social workers and carers.
Well, we interview Mary Belstead, who's the head of one of the big teaching unions, and she talks about research they've done with teachers And you know, it basically highlights that, you know, the attainment gap starts before a kid even gets to the school gate, before they even start primary school. So if you've got parents who are working for their poverty, in, you know, precarious employment, who maybe didn't get the support they needed when they went to school, so they're then having to support their children when they go to school. And they're already at a massive disadvantage, and so teachers are at the sharp end of this, and they're at the sharp end of this whilst their funding is decreasing massively, their workload is increasing. So, you know, there's so many areas, and it is a complex issue, but I think as a city, we can work together to make things better.
And do you think the people who are in those more privileged areas, because let's be honest about this, we're talking about an underprivileged area and a privileged sector of the city, do these people in that more privileged, are they aware of these differences?
I've got a funny feeling they aren't, and, you know, as I said to you before we started the interview, I don't want to point the finger of blame at any single person or any single group in this podcast series. The point of it is to open up a discussion with people. And I think there's a lot of people that are making the most of their advantages, as people do, but they are unaware that the impact that has on people who are less advantaged than them. And really, that's the discussion I want to have with people. That's the story I want to highlight.
And of course, generationally, if you have a generation going through this situation now, then they're going to be out there making it worse for the next generation and the next generation, to the point that actually these will become ghettos, won't they?
Yeah, I mean, that's a horrible thought, isn't it? That, you know, we end up in a situation where things get so bad that you know, we start talking about areas like ghettos. I mean, one of the episodes, episode 2 in the series, is all about Whitehawk and its history. I've interviewed lots of older people who grew up in the area when it was first sort of built in the sort of 60s. And, you know, I don't know how much you know about that, but, you know, people were moved out of the slums in the city centre to places like Whitehawk. And these older people talked about this stigma and the perception of council estates as being impacted by that sort of thing. And that's another discussion I want to have, you know, with the wider community in Brighton and Hove, this open and sort of liberal city, that there are places on the outskirts of Brighton that have community, that have lovely people, that have warmth and, you know, people that are working hard and trying to do the right thing for their communities. And I think on the whole, they're invisible to a lot of people in the city.
I think that's very true. I think it's really important that we start talking about this. And I know there's been lots of activity on supporting East Brighton and the other areas that once would have been known as sink estates. Mm. And it's a terrible phrase. Mm. It's a terrible, terrible phrase. And I grew up on a council estate. We never thought of ourselves to be very different, but we didn't have that issue of being told we had to go to a school where everyone in that area had the same problems. That 37% statistic strikes me as being really terrifying when you apply it to perhaps just one class of kids. That within that one class, 37% of them will fail.
Yeah. It's frightening, and you add on top of that, you know, the free school meals data, which really highlights the imbalance in where kids that need extra support are going. At schools like Long Hill and Backer, you've got over 30% of their children. Actually, at Backer, it's over 40% of the kids there on free school meals. At some of the city centre schools, it's as low as 12%. And it's that kind of imbalance that is affected by the catchment area and admissions process. It's why it needs to change, because I think all schools should be supporting kids from all sorts of different backgrounds and not saying, I want to make sure we get as many kids from this area because we know that's going to make our Ofsted results and our exam results even better and make us look good.
Well, let's hope that your podcasts have some sort of impact and move things forward. And let's just remember that there are lots of teachers working in education in some of those schools that we've mentioned who are working very, very hard to redress the balance.
So absolutely.
That is a really important thing to remember. Thank you so much for coming in. That's all we've got time for this evening from me. I'll be back next week with more arts and entertainment, but until then, it's good night. Good night.